Welcome to my talk. My name is Tino Eiter and I'm with Active Fiber Systems in Jena, Germany. And I want to talk about ultra high photon flux, high harmonic generation. I'm actually jumping in for my colleague Sven Breitkopf, who was planned to be actually at your site today, who cannot be there, unfortunately, due to some COVID disease. So I will try my best to replace him. And this work I'm presenting is a cooperation between AFS, between Jena University and between Delft University in the Netherlands. Let me start with a small change, a change in our company logo. Since beginning of this year, Active Fiber Systems is now a member of the Triumph Group. So this means we have now a strong partner who will support us in developing our laser system, developing our company. To start with Active Fiber Systems, so basically the idea was to transform research laser systems in commercially available systems. Our main market is research, both fundamental, also materials processing and life science. And today we are technological leader for high power ultrafast fiber lasers in terms of highest average power, high peak power, shortest pulses, and so on. And we are a strongly growing company. You see on the bottom left, now achieving 45 to 50 employees. What I want to talk today about today is these high harmonic sources, and these are based on our 1 micron driving sources, terbium-based fiber laser systems, and our high power XUV beam lines afterwards. In principle, also we are offering this recently, these new systems based on thulium operating at 2 micron wavelengths, which is also an interesting alternative. So starting with these laser systems, showing on the left, here you see this tabletop system consisting of the laser and nonlinear compression, I will explain more later on, and a frequency conversion. These are compact sources. We have already realized photon energies between 20 electron volts and 150 electron volts. And like I said, if you drive this with our thulium-based sources or mid-IR lasers, we can scale the photon energy even to the water window and, or even to the kilo electron volt region. Very briefly about the process, we are using a gas target harmonics, meaning we are focusing on short, intense infrared pulse into a gas target, and there we achieve intensities in the range of 10 to the 14 watts per square centimeter. And there we convert a part of the light into shorter wavelength, shorter pulses. And of course, the application for this kind of coherent radiation, there are plenty of possibilities, starting from surface science to atomic molecular physics, spectroscopy, or imaging applications. To go more into detail in these applications, we have on one side a very prominent example of coherent diffractive imaging, exploiting the really short wavelength of the radiation and achieving a very good resolution. We have experiments like coincidence experiments where we really need for the statistics is higher average power and higher repetition rate. And the same is true for photo emission applications, which is being performed by also many groups in the world today. To go into more details, if you're looking at the photoelectron spectroscopy, we have space charging effects, which result in a demand for a repetition rate as high as possible, ranging from up to hundreds of kilohertz, even to the megahertz level. The same is true for the coincidence applications I've shown earlier. Here you really want to have per pulse in an optimum less than one event to do your statistic, and here also repetition rate is favorable. And for all these applications, it's true that you want to avoid long integration times and you want to have a signal to noise ratio as high as possible. So this results in a demand for a high photon flux. So in principle, these sources are based on either titanium sapphire, which has been the working horse in the last decades. There you end up with kilohertz repetition rates, or you start as a driving laser with the terbium-based systems. Like today, I want to present fiber-based systems, so you can end up with a megahertz level. Of course, at megahertz, your pulse energy is lower, and this brings, of course, the question for the efficiency, which has typically was driven these harmonics with multi-millijoule titanium sapphire systems. And there has been a strong development. And to take a look at this, we look at the phase matching condition. And of course, this phase matching has to be fulfilled to achieve this nonlinear, an efficient nonlinear process. And in principle, you see part of the equation, which is basically the dispersion resulting from the atoms and the free electrons. This is a positive value. And on the right hand side, you have the focusing is a negative value, and you have to cancel out these values. So on the left hand, you see that with the gas pressure, you can tune this dispersion part of the equation. And of course, here on the right hand side, you see this value is positive if your ionization rate is smaller than the critical ionization rate with a gas specific value. And for this case, you have a pressure tuned phase matching region. And what can be shown, and which has been demonstrated many times in the lab, that your efficiency is independent of the focusing conditions, meaning that you can achieve the same efficiency with microjoule class fiber lasers than with millijoule class titanium sapphire systems. However, if you want to achieve short pulses as possible, and this we will need if you want to go to higher photon energies, we typically start from 300 femtoseconds or 250 femtosecond fiber laser system, and it's typically too long these pulses to achieve really high photon energies. What we are doing is a nonlinear compression in noble gas, for example, hollow core waveguides. And you see in the picture here, you start up with your 300 femtosecond pulse, you spectrally broaden due to SPM your pulse in this capillary, and then you compress the pulse with a choked mirrors to, in this case, to smaller than 30 femtoseconds. And with this technology, up to 400 watts of average power have been achieved. And I've shown more at the end of this talk, even with multipass cell MPC technology, we can go to the kilowatt level. The advantage is you have flexible pulse parameters and your average power scalable with this technology. If this 30 femtoseconds is not enough, you can even compress it down with a second stage. You're doing the same, and you can end up in the few cycle regime. In this case, for sub 7 femtoseconds, up to 216 watts have been achieved. For sub 10 femtoseconds, slightly longer pulses, more than 300 watts of average power has been achieved at even higher energies. Let's take a look now at a system. We start with a standard ytterbium 100 watt 1 millijoule class system shown here, which demonstrates excellent power stability, excellent pointing stability, and a very good beam quality. And with this laser system, here's the top view of this on the lower right as the laser system. Then we go to this nonlinear compression. In this example here, I'm talking today about this is a capillary based compression. And then we end up, the system is not running at full energy, but at a higher repetition rate at 60 watts, 40 femtoseconds, 120 microjoule pulse energy at 500 kilohertz. And this is the driving laser for the harmonics. And on the left side, you see the gas jet in the harmonic chamber, and we have a separation of the high power infrared beam from the XUV beam then in the left chamber. And you see, of course, this excellent stability of the laser system transfers to the stability of the nonlinear compression. Here you see nearly 67 of watts with a very, very good average power stability over 15 hours of operation. These are the results of the harmonics. Here, on the lower side, you see the spectrum of two different photon energies optimization. And you see for the different harmonics and different photon energies, we end up with a flux measured in photons per second per 1% bandwidth, exceeding for the lower four photon energies, even 10 to the 11 photons per second. And for the higher energies, 10 to the more than 10 to the 10 photons per second, which state record fluxes in this range from such a compact tabletop source. To bring this into perspective, here's a plot of the photon energy and the average power of the harmonics, of the single harmonics. And here's these two modes of operations I've shown before, this lower energy and this higher photon energy. And you see these fiber laser driven sources are really have excellent power values in this case. This shows all this, these fiber laser driven sources are really, really interesting for a lot of applications. The system has been installed by our customer in TU Delft within the LINX project. It's basically the application and imaging applications and the project together with ASML. Here you see also a measurement of the stability of the harmonics. You see over long time operation and the fluctuation of each single harmonics. So these are the different harmonics are typically below 1%, and also of the complete system show very good stability, which really brings you advantages for your application, for your measurements. Basically, this is a video created from our customer from the LINX project from Delft University, and this shows on the right hand side shows the laser, and this is now a view in the target chamber where this I've shown them before. These imaging applications are performed with this laser and optimized regarding resolution, regarding measurement time, and so on. This all brings me already to the first conclusion of the talk. I've shown you a flexible harmonic generation source with very compact design. You see it's, let's say, 2 meters or 2.5 meter times 1.5 meter, resulting in a record high photon flux at 80 nanometers and in the range between the interesting range between 10 and 12.4 nanometers. In numbers, at 80 nanometers, we have 3 times 10 to the 11 photons per second. In at 10 nanometers, still 1.9 times 10 to the 10 photons per second. Let me conclude, not with a conclusion, but with an outlook. What can we do to further scale these sources? Of course, we can scale if this fiber systems the average power, and we can go from fiber compression to multipass cell compression. So the next two slides are the recent results we achieved with our laser system, which is now installed at the HR1 laser system in the Eli Alt in Hungary. And there we start with a more powerful system. This is an 8-channel fiber CBA system, 8 coherently combined channels. And we're starting with 180 watts of average power, 1.8 millijoule and 300 femtoseconds. And we use the first compression stage. This is the dark one. The glowing one is the few cycle compression stage. And with the first compression stage with dielectric mirrors, we end up with 170 watts and 1.7 millijoule and 35 femtoseconds. So it's extremely efficient, this first stage. And in the second stage, which is basically on metal mirrors, on silicon substrates, cooled silicon substrates, we end up with more than 100 watts of average power of only 5.8 femtoseconds, which is basically a record value in this few cycle multipass cell compression. And the system has been installed. Here's a measured pulse shape measured with a D-scan device. It's 5.8 femtoseconds, very clean pulse shape. Excellent beam quality, excellent stability. And here you see it's additionally a ZP stable, using a ZP stable oscillator and then stabilization. So this is an ideal source for isolated attosecond pulses and at really high average powers and repetition rates in this case. With this, I want to thank you for your attention. And thanks.